This is more than another film. This is how we can all make a difference. You've seen the climate getting worse. Are you ready to change and sacrifice a lot? You don't have to. If we all just change a little, we can do great things. Let's use the power of many. E.ON enables and connects 50 million customers across Europe. That's an incredible community. One green energy contract, one solar panel, one smart home doesn't feel like much. But multiplied by millions, that's true potential. Together, we can change the world for the better by putting each other first. We are better together because none of us is as strong as all of us. Let's not only believe that, but use it to create something big. We are ready. Are you ready to become an energy change maker too? Every change counts because the we has no limits.
Good afternoon. I'm Ed Clarke, Managing Director for the UK and Nordics Road Network for FedEx Express. I'm delighted to be able to join you today to discuss innovative solutions for delivering the critical last mile in urban centres. FedEx Express is an express transportation provider with what we recognise as a sizeable global footprint. We connect 99% of the world's GDP via an air fleet of almost 700 aircraft and have over 180,000 motorised vehicles. Today, I'm going to talk to you about the need for innovative last mile solutions for urban transport, whilst also providing some practical solutions for fleet operators. The industry has made significant strides towards logistics solutions that are economical, efficient, and more environmentally friendly, but there is a long way to go. In the next 10 minutes or so, I will discuss why thinking and planning for logistics as an essential and desirable service in our cities opens the door to the most sustainable solutions. By 2050, it's projected that more than two-thirds of the world's population will live in urban areas. In the last 50 years, urbanisation has accelerated exponentially, and the cities have cemented themselves as the main powerhouses of economic growth. We have seen increased expectation from both consumers and businesses that goods should be able to move freely and quickly through these business districts and neighbourhoods. The e-commerce boom has brought greater demand and expectation than ever before. Same-day delivery has become an industry standard, and in some cities you can order items to be delivered within just a few hours. This trend has accelerated during the COVID-19 pandemic, with a recent study revealing that 77% of consumers shopping online during the lockdown period expect to continue this behaviour when the pandemic ends. Clearly, a continued long-term boom in e-commerce brings higher demand for delivery services and inevitably sharpens the focus on innovating more sustainably focused last-mile solutions. At FedEx, we don't take it lightly that 92% of our own business emissions come from our air and ground transportation networks. On top of this, the industry is experiencing an increased demand for consumers to receive goods in the quickest, cheapest way, set alongside the desire for governments, policymakers, and the very same consumers to create a more environmentally friendly operating model. As logistics providers, the business we do day in and day out, and the global network in which we operate, means that we're acutely aware of our responsibility to the environment and the change that we can affect. At a macro level, Europe is committed to being the first carbon neutral continent by 2050. But these plans and ambitious targets sit in a context of an accelerating e-commerce boom. Even before the COVID-19 pandemic, the World Economic Forum forecasts that demand for urban last mile delivery is anticipated to grow by 78% by 2030. this would generate an astonishing 30% increase in emissions in our urban centres over the next 10 years. We recognise the importance and the critical need to balance this rising demand in e-commerce with the need to minimise environmental impact. As an industry, we need to be ready and able to respond to the need of countries, communities, and citizens whilst proactively addressing the impact of continued growing demand. FedEx Express operates a global transportation network, and therefore our responsibility extends well beyond Europe. As such, we recognise the leadership role we have to play in the fight against climate change. We have chosen focus areas where we, as an industry, recognise we face the biggest challenges and have the biggest opportunity to drive change. We have emission saving programmes in place and have set ambitious targets to increase efficiency across both air and ground operations. We have already achieved some positive results. Between 2009 and 2019, our average daily package volume grew by 99.2%. Over the same period, we reduced the intensity of our CO2 emissions by 40%. Our own sustainability approach, reduce, replace, and revolutionise, guides efforts across all sectors of our business towards more sustainable practices. Reduce. Whether increasing efficiency of our vehicles or planes, or directly reducing the amount of fuel that we use, we are reducing the impact of what we do. FedEx works with its customers to fulfil their logistics needs in the most efficient and environmentally friendly way. Consolidating package volumes and planning routes to directly reduce the number of vehicles on the roads. Replace. We are continuously replacing ageing aircraft and upgrading motorised vehicles to modernise our fleet. But we also strive to adopt newer technologies and identify environmentally friendly alternatives to current processes. Revolutionise. Almost 50 years ago, FedEx pioneered the express transportation industry. But entrepreneurship and innovation remain in our DNA. And as an industry leader, we want to transition and transform our industry by adopting the revolutionary technologies and solutions, such as aviation fuels, early adoption of robotics, and semi-autonomous trucking. Efforts to decarbonise take many forms, and we shouldn't wait for technologies to become available. We must consider how to adapt and use what we have available to us now. At FedEx, we've begun a research and scoping project to create a modular approach to city centre logistics in Europe. Our planning and engineering departments have developed proof of concept programs combining micro-mobility methods in response to unique circumstances in areas of London, Paris, Amsterdam, Milan, Madrid, and in Frankfurt. In these cities, we're exploring combined use of cargo bikes, foot couriers, waterways, rail, and even micro depots to make use of vacant parking spaces at the edge of zero emission zones. We have introduced a small number of cargo bikes to serve boroughs in London with very promising results. Using cargo bikes proved just as efficient as vehicles in these postcodes and has had no negative effect on service, whether collecting or delivering goods to our customers. From pilot projects we have run into zero emission zones in London, we estimate that cargo bicycles can meet as much as 95% of the pickup and delivery needs in these neighbourhoods, which reduce both the road space and the curbside parking space needed to help reduce congestion and improve safety in densely populated city areas. Longer term, we're looking to create different types of satellite hubs from which e-bikes, lightweight e-vans or foot couriers can collect and recharge. In some areas, these bases can also act as customer collection points. Another area that we're currently exploring is how to be smarter with rail connections between airports, city hubs and out-of-town depots. Smarter use of rail could take trucks off the road and get more packages into the middle of our cities faster. We should all lean on rail connections more than we currently do. Reducing the distance covered by road and focusing on rail could lead to emission reductions of up to 26%. The possibility of working with rail companies could have huge potential, but we must cooperate and collaborate to make this happen. For example, in Madrid, we have offered the proposal to set up a micro hub that manages the use of unused parking capacity in the main railway station, since the station is ideally situated right on the edge of four zero emission zones in the city. This solution promises to improve curbside management by making use of vacant car parking. As operators, we welcome the opportunity to develop these collaborative solutions since they benefit everyone. Ultimately, a location closer to the restricted zones opens up a broader wealth of opportunities for zero emissions delivery in these zones. If we are to maintain the ideal balance between the economic wealth of our cities with the environmental health, we should look to build closer collaboration between the industry, policymakers, and urban planning authorities. Together, we can develop a safer, cleaner, and more efficient ways of moving goods around urban environments. As an industry, we need to work with the local authorities to align the solutions that we are working on for logistics with the solutions the cities are encouraging and investing in from a mobility perspective. Combining micro-mobility methods to make use, in some cases, of a variety of solutions we already have now will allow us to adapt to zero-emission methods in line with local infrastructure and needs. With collaboration, we have the potential to make more immediate impact and find delivery solutions that are convenient, sustainable, and safe for citizens. If we work together to understand and shape the solutions available to us, we can do the very best with what we have available today. At FedEx Express, we will continue to innovate and identify the most suitable, sustainable practices to meet the last mile demand. As European e-commerce continues to boom, we are readying our business to deliver more and impact less. Thank you.
So good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this live Q&A mobility session on innovative last mile solutions for urban transport. I'm Steve Bryars, Editor-in-Chief of Fleet News, and I'm delighted to be joined by our session speaker, Ed Clarke, Managing Director, Hub Operations at FedEx Express UK, and also from our sponsor, Darren Gardner, Director of E.ON Drive Infrastructure. Good afternoon to you both. So this is our audience's opportunity to ask some questions. So please get those questions into me. But while I'm waiting, so Ed, thanks for that insightful look into how FedEx is tackling the challenges of urban distribution. Can I start by asking you about the layout and location of your distribution hubs and depots and how that's having to change to reflect new local authority demands for cleaner transport?
Yeah, sure. And this has been a real challenge for us over the previous years. Several different things have happened, like the London Olympics, whereby facilities that we had that were close to our core markets were compulsory purchased. And we've had to move further and further away from the core distribution areas in our cities. And this has had a negative impact for us because that leaves us with less and less options enabling us to affect those deliveries. So, we've had things like a clean water pumping station that was for our Vauxhall location. And each time that this has happened, we've had to move further and further out, further afield. And that's limited the amount of different solutions that we can run. And what we really need support for to have is having some very close to market facilities. Now, they don't have to be as large as what we have traditionally used. Smaller scale units that enable us to be in our core areas and then to affect things like using bikes, walkers, electric vehicles, and a whole sort of cafe of different solutions will really be an enabler for us in the future. But it's really cool that we work with both planning officials and local government to be able to secure that you know, highly prized commodity of land right in the core of our cities in the future.
And obviously doing that can really make a massive difference to your emissions and your emissions contribution. Are you finding that local authorities are more open to that conversation now?
I think that people are actually more open to the conversation and realising what we need. I haven't actually seen that really transition into end results just yet. Pan-Europeanly, we're actually trying to work in Milan at the moment to secure some car parking space. I mentioned that earlier on, which would enable us to have a micro facility that would enable us to deliver to those local areas. And by using those more green, CO2 efficient facilities that we could put together, 95% of everything we do could still be serviced using that new model, which would be a fantastic improvement for us.
And if you had those more central depots, I guess that would certainly help you as well in terms of electrification. Are you doing much work at the moment in the UK in terms of charging up your depots? And if so, how are you kind of managing that process to avoid the cost of having to upgrade the grid?
Yeah, and that's a real problem for us. Now, FedEx is a global business. We operate in 220 countries across the world. And what that actually means is that some of our trials aren't in the UK or even in Europe. We've got some large-scale electrification trials out in China at the moment, which we're pursuing and understanding what that can deliver for us as a business. But one of the real barriers for us actually in the UK is being able to adopt a large-scale electrification of vehicles, because the facilities that we have in our buildings just don't have the infrastructure. The pipeline electricity that coming into them isn't suitable and sufficient for the demands. I was recently looking at in our head office, and just to put a few charge points outside our head office, was going to look at about a £20,000 investment in terms of trying to step up the flow of electricity to just have a few vehicles being able to charge themselves, let alone a whole location where there could be over 100 vehicles based there. So, yeah, the infrastructure is a real challenge for us at the moment to really sort of get that electrification to that last mile or first mile delivery piece.
It's a perfect opportunity for you to come in, Darren, in terms of how can E.ON help companies electrify their fleets, and in particular identify the right type of chargers, and also to manage those issues of the sort of local grid capacity.
Yes, thanks, Stephen. That's a perfect segue, actually. it's a common problem. We want to electrify our fleet, but we don't have the grid capacity or the infrastructure to cope with that unless I pay £20,000 in your case. So I guess that's probably where E.ON adds value, is that we both understand mobility and that we're a fleet operator ourselves, but also that we understand grids and that we understand electricity supply. And I suppose there are some things that we do that would help you avoid that £20,000. So little things, we call it dynamic load management, which is effectively managing the demand of the chargers in real time to help reduce the overall peak demand, is what we call it. And those little tricks can actually avoid you or other customers like you needing to upgrade the grid. And we've just launched something called what we call PD Hero, which is an artificial intelligence tool which helps manage the whole of your electricity demand, not just for your fleet, but also for the building and the site as well. And so it's those sorts of things that we're able to help large and small businesses avoid just the easy option, but the expensive option is to go to the grid operator and say, can I have some more capacity, please? And they send you an invoice. That's the easy but the expensive thing to do. And so I guess that's the bit where we come in, is to try and help customers reduce that peak demand down so that you can actually electrify your fleet. Beyond that point, it's what type of chargers do you need is almost that's the easy thing. It's what kind of fleet do you operate? Are you back to base? Are you overnight charging? Or are you expecting, people to come into your site and need only going to be there for a couple of hours and then drive 200 miles up the motorway? And in which case you need a faster charge, Or do you want to do some really fun things with your charging, like take all of the spare battery capacity and then sell that back to the national grid? So there's all those sorts of things that, you know, we as an operator try and tease out with our customers to say, look, how do you want to manage your fleet? How's it being used? How far do you drive? All those sorts of things. And then that then leads to the type of what charging points do you need and how many do you need of them? But the critical thing is that you need 100% renewable electricity, really, going to those charging points. Otherwise, there really is very little point. There's probably some point, but why move from petrol or diesel? So I guess that's how we try and help customers like FedEx.
Okay, so Ed, FedEx has been looking at a lot of alternatives for last mile deliveries. How viable are things like e-bikes and drones and drone robots for those for that sort of last mile part of your operation?
So we've actually just been doing a trial in London in one of our locations, Bermondsey, whereby we've been using an e-bike, and we've had some fantastic success with it. And in the new year, we'll be expanding that to a second location in London as part of our learning of this trial, based on the success of the first stage in Bermondsey. The bikes can take about 95% of everything that comes in for the routes that they're covering. And we've actually been able to establish a straight swap, one bike for one van, which is phenomenal. You know, I'm really pleased that we can take a van off the road by having the addition of a bike. And we've had to learn and work in a slightly different way. Obviously, the payload of a bike, even with a storage pod on the back, is less than a van. And so sometimes we organise for a bike to meet up with a van and pass off some of its load and continue its work. And in doing this, we found that the unit can actually do the same productivity as with running a traditional diesel vehicle. In fact, I was looking at some of the stats earlier on today, and from Bermondsey to central London, it can take me an hour to get a van in, whilst the bike is getting in just over 20 minutes. So there's a real win in terms of that stem time for us by utilising that vehicle. And it's great to see those sort of things being developed and rolled out. And I really look forward to expanding that further, as I said, into new locations within London in the following year. And it's part of a programme that we're adopting across sort of 8 cities in Europe, to build together a portfolio of solutions for us to use. You mentioned drones there. We've been doing some testing with some drones out in the US, in Memphis, with a good degree of success. I don't envisage that we'll ever see drones, you know, taking every shipment everywhere and, you know, hundreds of thousands of them in the air at any one time. But for very remote areas or for areas where there's problems, that they're a fantastic solution. And so that's something that we're definitely investigating and working with. I'm very proud to see that we've got the FedEx Bot, which is an autonomous delivery vehicle that can actually effect a delivery. And again, you know, a really superb solution. Some of the trials and the things we've been working on and looking at are things like someone maybe looking after a child and needing some medicine, not able to leave home and actually go to the chemist to pick that up, whereas a solution like this would be able to literally take it straight from the chemist to the customer's front door. And the unit that we've got, it's just incredible. It really is. It's able to navigate steps and all sorts of things, and holds real potential. Obviously, and I came back to the thing about sort of legislation, you know, currently that would require a change in legislation for us to be able to use that in public areas. But these things like drones and automated delivery bots, you know, they will be part of the future. You know, I don't know how much of the future market that will hold, but it will be part of that that suite of options that gets utilised.
So I've got a couple of safety related questions come in. One is looking at those drones and autonomous bots and how that impacts on your safety strategy and indeed your insurance premiums. And then another one related to your bike riders and how you're ensuring the safety of them as well.
Okay, yeah, so safety is the most important thing for us as a business. We're very privileged that whenever the chairman speaks, virtually the first message he always says in whatever address he's in is about safety above all. And I'm very proud of that fact. the bike is great. It's a very stable unit. It's a three-wheeled unit, so it's not someone just with a satchel trying to balance their load and drive through London. It's a very different sort of piece of equipment. It's electric. It's got a 40-mile battery and a spare 40-mile battery included in the unit that's going out. And as I said, we're in trials, and so we're assessing how it goes. But fantastic results so far. And it's in terms of things like drones and stuff, that understanding the complexities of those sort of issues is why we're running trials and assessing that information just now. And rest assured, we wouldn't do anything unless we were totally confident in the health and safety aspects of any of the changes that we're making. But these things, generally speaking, can help us. You know, they can help limit risk for different people. And if you think about environments maybe where there's you know, there's been an earthquake and there's damaged roads and things like that, and the infrastructure's impeded, that's where something like a drone can really reduce the risk to anyone, a human, actually entering those environments. So, you know, as I said, I think it's a suite of different options. We're assessing those things now, but I've got no concerns from my end at all.
And Darren, with companies like FedEx looking at new ways to deliver in sort of congested city centres, what are some of the things that E.ON's doing to actually help in those local councils as they work towards this electrified future?
Yes, we've been working with cities on a broader level to help them get to net zero by 2030 or 2050 for some time. We've been working with cities all over Europe, actually. And one of the, there's an interesting stat, I won't mention the name of the city, but the average commute was something like 3 or 4 kilometres a day, but the but 2 out of 3 people used a car for that commute. And so really, when we talk to cities, you know, they expect me to probably sell the electric vehicle. Actually, the answer is not the car in those cities. So I'm pretty sure that in those sort of urban, densely populated environments, actually the answer is things like the e-scooter, the e-bike, walking more, car sharing, and Uber, and those sorts of things. And where it is absolutely necessary, then car ownership will be part of the future, and it should be electric. But probably in those circumstances, actually, the answer is not the car. And one of the things that we worked with the city of Copenhagen on was, yes, we installed a network of 2,000 charging points across that city, but it was part of an overall decarbonisation and transport strategy with the city of Copenhagen. And so yes, there are publicly available charging points, but as part of that, we help create a car sharing club in that city. So I think I actually think it's things like that that will actually help improve air quality. Moving people into a different mode of transport has got to be what cities and future sort of mixed use developments, work, rest, play developments. So yes, people might expect me to say, yeah, more electric vehicles, more electric vehicle charging points. And part of me is saying yes to all of that. But actually, I think some of the advice that I would give to cities in particular is less car and better forms of public transport, which is obvious, really. But I think, you know, obviously, we've seen an announcement today from the government about 1.3 billion of funding, and that's going to be critical for public infrastructure. But let's remember that actually 62% of
I think Darren's frozen on us. Always have to check it's not me. You can still hear me, Ed?
I can indeed.
Okay. While we try and get Darren back, just move on. You talked about autonomous bots, but how do you view autonomous driving? There's a question that's come in asking whether it's a far-off dream or something more immediate.
So my own personal opinion is that something that will be coming in the longer term. I don't think that that's necessarily the next phase. I think that what will happen is that there'll be driver-assisted automation that comes in that improves where we are. I think we're still quite a way off from fully automated non-human involvement vehicles. But obviously you can see with the likes of Tesla and other companies that automation's playing a much stronger part. It's not unusual now to buy a vehicle that's got sensors that's looking how close you're travelling to the vehicle in front and giving you indications. Or if you start wavering from one lane to another, that it helps you. And that's where I think that I sort of see it going. I see sort of a semi-autonomous assistance, if you like, that happens in the medium, the short to medium term future. But I wouldn't be surprised if in the longer term future, and whether this is in my working life or not, who knows, that there would be maybe fully autonomous vehicles as well.
Okay. Darren, you're back. Would you like to, just in the couple of minutes we've got left, just finish off that point you were making around the public infrastructure?
Yeah, so sort of 1.3 billion for public infrastructure, and that's going to be needed as we all sort of move to electric vehicles. But of course, I suppose it's important to remember that 62% of people actually charge at home, and so whether or not we'll need to really invest in city infrastructure, I don't know. I think time will tell, and with battery ranges increasing. 300 miles in a Tesla, that's going to be small beer soon, so people can charge at home for 15 pence per kilowatt hour compared to paying sort of 50-60p out on a public network. Whether or not that will be a huge need, I can imagine it for a business like Ed's, for example, might well be needed. So I guess that was my sort of final point.
Okay. It's great that you could get back to us to finish off that point just in time as well, because I think we need to wrap up now. So we've reached the 3:30 mark. Just like to remind visitors that if you would like to find out more about electric vehicle solutions, and it's obviously a hugely topical subject given this week's government announcements on the petrol diesel ban in 2030, then head over to the experts on the E.ON stand. But you can also head to the networking lounge as well to continue the conversation. So you have around half an hour now for networking with our exhibitors before our final session of this year's Virtual Fleet and Mobility Live, which is on procurement best practice with the Association of Fleet Professional board member, Chris Joyce. So it just leaves me to say thanks to Ed and Darren, and for the rest of you, enjoy the rest of the show.